we're all familiar with the idea of the third world, underprivileged people emerging out of deprivation. But today there's also emerging a fourth world, people in the cities of the affluent West who are slipping back into deprivation. They aren't conspicuous. They don't go about dressed in rags, but they are among us in every city in Europe. One little part of this fourth world can be found in the east end of Glasgow, an island of council houses with the lyrical name of Lily Bank. This is a story of Lily Bank and of every Lily Bank in Europe. Tonight we highlight one woman's attempt to find out for herself what it's like to be part of the fourth world. She shed her middle class identity. She became an impoverished widow calling herself Mrs. Cathy Price. And for 3 months, she went to live in poverty in the place called Lily Bank.
Mrs. Price came here and she had nobody, she never knew anybody, and she came to my shack, my door, and I brought her in. Well, she was lonely, she was only on her own. And I think she was just...
I'll tell you this much, when she went up the stair, I mean, when the woman did go up the stair, there was nothing in the house at all.
Oh, scandalous.
She had only a bed and a wee sort of a table and a typewriter, I think.
That was all. She had nothing. She had nothing.
She had something, I don't know what it was, a typewriter.
All she had in that house, if you want to know, was a single bed, a typewriter, and one chair. That's what she had up the stair. That's all the woman had.
Cathy Price was in fact the pseudonym adopted by one of the most eminent social workers in Britain, Kay Carmichael, senior lecturer in social work and administration at Glasgow University, deputy chairman of the Supplementary Benefits Commission, and one-time member of Harold Wilson's Downing Street think tank. There, her task was to speak for the poor and the underprivileged, for the fourth world. Then she got a sabbatical from Glasgow University, a term's leave, in effect, to work on her own. She could have gone to distant and exotic places to study deprivation at first hand. Instead, she chose the jungle on her own doorstep, in the city where she lived, but not just to study poverty, to experience it.
I wanted to experience, because I think that, at the end of the day, is the only way really to know something, is to have a feeling experience of it as well as an intellectual one. But there was another level at which I was involved and for which it was a personal journey for me, and that was that in going into the East End of Glasgow I would be going back in a sense to my own childhood. I took a taxi and I took with me my radio, my tape recorder, a few books and a change of clothes. And absurdly, I left this house clutching a sweeping brush. And that really was a very primitive kind of response. And that was really going back to my early childhood and with a grandmother whose automatic instinct in any new house that she moved in or anywhere she was, in fact, was to clean the house.
Kay Carmichael had known the East End of Glasgow in her childhood. She was brought up in a tenement there by a grandmother who left a deep impression on her. Her name had also been Cathy Price.
Now, you took on the identity of your grandmother, Mrs. Cathy Price.
Took on her name.
Not her identity?
Well, I don't think I could. She was a remarkable lady. And I think perhaps I borrowed some of her strengths in that situation. She had been left a widow just after the First World War, and she brought my mother and her three sisters up in a room and kitchen in Shettleston Road. And she was really the most important person in my life because in my early childhood, my mother went back to live with her, and she gave me the kind of mothering and caring that I think gave me whatever strengths that I may have. My mother had to go back out to work, and she looked after me when my mother was away.
So this was also an odyssey of self-discovery.
Yes.
As well as an academic exercise.
It was an exercise in discovering how I would be in a situation where my structures were taken away from me, how it would be for me to be poor. You know, how would I survive?
But I'd have thought that you knew more than most already about poverty because you are deputy chairman of the Supplementary Benefits Commission.
Well, sitting around a table in London is not quite the same kind of thing. And certainly I can read the statistics that are produced and look at, you know, household expenditure surveys. But that is a very different matter, I think, from actually trying to do it yourself.
The place where Kay Carmichael tried to do it herself is a local authority housing scheme of 534 homes. Each entrance, or close as they call it in Scotland, leads to six flats, mostly three apartments with kitchen and bathroom. Lily Bank was born in optimism over 40 years ago on green fields to provide a new decency and dignity for the casualties of the Depression in Glasgow.
I'm here 44 years. It was a beautiful place at first, the greatest place in the world to stay. Well, the great people, nice winds and everything, nice people.
This was farmed land. We came up to this place, it was country. Closes us off these stairs, and there were big families, 14 in here. There was 10 down the stair and 10 next door to that. There was over 40 children in this close at one time. Over 40. That was before I was married. This was a great place.
It was a great place, a great community. And on the surface, you might think it still is a tidy urban housing scheme. Indeed, the houses are just being modernised at a cost to Glasgow of some £4,000 each. But behind the facade, Lily Bank is now a profoundly depressed area.
See, oh, the rough laughs of the day comes up here. They'll come up here, I don't know where they come from. But, it's the last place on earth this is.
One time they were putting people in to the scheme and the sanitary lady that used to come round objected to it. They were putting the scum of Glasgow into it then. And she stopped coming round, seeing that the houses were all clean. Am I right, Isa? So fae then, it has deteriorated. Certain parts of the scheme, but this building's quite all right. But when you look out the window, you see the gangs running about, you know, young ones, 13 to 15. But the biggest majority of them don't stay in the scheme. They just come over here. Am I right?
I don't know whether it was actual boys at the gang fight that set fire to the house, you know.
Kay Carmichael applied for a three-month lease of a council flat for a research survey, supposedly by one of her students. Instead, she went underground herself. She was allotted incognito a newly modernised top-floor flat at number 90 Dunning Street.
I got there. And I was absolutely and totally shattered because the house had been modernized and left precisely in the state that the workmen had left it, so that paper was hanging off the walls. The floor was covered with rubble and litter of all kinds. The front windows facing onto the street were all broken, five of them. And what had happened was that the local children, very reasonably, had been using them as target practice for stones. And they, in the weeks to come, they continued to practice in this way. And at regular intervals, I would hear a clatter of more, even more glass breaking in the front room, which I wasn't able to use at all.
It did.
I don't know how that woman slept. You know, it was winter time when she came in.
Nobody was in the living room. A single bed just lay up and down there, and she had no window in.
You know, half of the windows was out. You know, I wouldn't say they were all out, but half of them was out.
Kay Carmichael had calculated that a destitute widow like Cathy Price would qualify for an exceptional needs payment of £140 with which to set up house in Lily Bank. So that was a limit she set herself. But she had to change more than just her standard of living. In order to be accepted, she also had to learn to look and sound and feel like a woman of Lily Bank.
I watched what people wore, and I watched how they walked. And I listened to what they said. The most interesting discovery in that was how people walked. Because if you get the profile of someone, there are significant social class differences between the way they carry themselves. And in fact, all the time I was living in Lily Bank, I had to make an effort to walk differently, to hold my body quite differently, to slump. Not to hold myself erect, to look a little bit defeated, so that I deliberately learned how to look rather worried most of the time. It meant I had to look at the kind of clothes I wore. It meant I had to look at the way I got my hair done and cut, you know, my makeup, to really examine all the kind of middle class techniques and structures that I use in order to present a certain image to the world. My voice, very important, because, again, I have learned that if you say something in a certain way, something usually happens. People pay some kind of attention to it.
So you had to learn Palermo, Glasgow.
I had to learn to go back in terms of my own experience and try to remember the sounds, intonations that every Glasgow working child has to use.
Can you give me an example of how you spoke?
No, I can't. I think it would be quite artificial and dishonest to do that. It took me about 2 weeks to get my ear tuned and my voice tuned to the sounds. And in fact, it was an astonishing experience to be walking in a street in your own city where you have lived virtually all your life and not to be able to understand what the children were saying.
Me and my wee pal walked up, we get chips and that, and they were this guy and the chippy, and his up, so we started eyeing him up and that. And when we got our chips, we walked to the chip shop and he didn't buy nothing. So he comes running out, grabs his toys, flings me into the Lyson grocer's shutter. The other one outside, flung him on the road, he kicked in the heat, and then he ran. And I was still getting full bricks and he'd not out of Britain.
For Kay Carmichael, life as Mrs. Cathy Price in the fourth world of Lily Bank was a lonely and harrowing experience. She was seeing it as social workers seldom do.
It's hostile and it's ugly. And there were times here I would go back to the house and my eyes would literally be hurting with the pain of never having anything beautiful to look at, of everything being dissonant and difficult. And it's as if the whole world is hostile, that there's nothing that comforts you. And this is why a place like the park is so important because that's one place in the world that's got something beautiful in it. You know, there are flowers and there's a bit of orderliness in the world. Now, this world in which we're walking just now is a world where there doesn't seem to be any pattern.
Yes.
For anything that's going on.
Except debris.
Debris, dirt, rubbish, and there is no way in which you can take anything for granted about life. I mean, you can't trust anything that happens. And of course, this is the essence of a hostile environment.
How did you find consolation?
I went to the park and I went to the library, and libraries are so important. If local authorities only realise this, particularly as a way of giving children opportunities. But the children here, you see, can't use that library very freely because, in fact, the territory between here and the library is like enemy country that they've got to make their way through.
When you get in that park, the nearest on park, you get chased by all the rebels and you end up fighting with them. And if you got that park up there, Tulsa's Park, you end up fighting with all the Tulleks, me man. Then if you hang about here, stun their clothes or something, you get a jail for loitering. Play it fit, or you get a jail for disturbing the peace or something.
There's nothing to do at night time, and there's no parks or nothing. When you get to a park, you always get battered with the gangs and all that, and or fights and all that.
You end up doing bad things on here.
Oh, you're right. It drives you to do bad things, I'm telling you.
Well, you're right there.
And at night time there's an awful lot of stolen motors and you can't get to sleep for them. And they bring them out here and they burn them for nothing. They're brand new motors as well.
Can you tell me how this car got here?
A couple of ones stole it, Philip. Just brought it down here. Burnt it. So we just used it for a den, that. It's not bad really for sitting in it, that. It's nothing, that.
Has this happened quite often, cars getting stolen?
Aye.
And do the police do anything about it?
We kind of catch them.
Have you ever done it?
Ah. Not yet.
If you did steal a car, would you know how to drive it?
Aye.
How do you know how to drive a car?
Because you get learnt. Some of the big boys learn you to drive and that. And then with the rain motors, you just take shots from the street and that. And they just say, you're passed. No, it's just like a driver's lesson or something. It's not bad, really.
If you jump about the other, yeah, you end up sniffing glue and all that. Smashing windies. Get to jail for what? Street walking and all that, I know. Screwing motors.
Shut up, you.
You boy.
Stop
walking. Oh, no, there's a cover boy.
Ducky boy.
The aggression in small children frightened the life out of me. To see two under fives really attacking each other quite viciously without any of the modifications that one normally expects. You know, even with two puppies playing, you get all kinds of ritual observances. And it was as if these small children hadn't had the kind of socialization experience that let them know there were limits to their interaction.
I was lasting, they're still fighting back. Well, they're about four of them, about 17, 18. That. Well, that was all right, tall cross mob, because they had the motor sitting outside it, outside around the corner, waiting for them to get away. So, nothing we could do. Our boys were sitting in the back here, drinking that. Nothing else we could do. No, but so. We all ran in there, ran up the railway, and we seen the motor. So we just smashed the motor up. And then they all came up, so we just started a fight.
I saw the potentiality in these children, both for creativity and for destructive destructive behaviour. To see a little girl, for example, as I did one day, sitting, working with a kind of pile of dirty earth and trying to make a pattern with broken bits of stone. And you suddenly saw that marvellous capacity in human beings that wherever they are, they want to change their environment and do something constructive with it. But then when I looked at her again, I saw that she was already, in a sense, branded. She would be about 4. And her ears were pierced and she had earrings in. I mean, if I ever saw a place that needed preschool playgroup groups, it was there. And the physical appearance of the children seemed to me distressing very often. I think it almost certainly has something to do with diet and lack of sleep and all the other things that go with poverty. There were some lovely children, of course, there always are. But there were others who were marked with the stigmata of deprivation by the time they were 3 years of age. And I particularly thought of this the other week when I was down in Cambridge and saw a group of beautiful children presenting a mystery play in King's College Chapel. And there I saw these youngsters between about 8 and 10 with good hair and good teeth and lovely skin and clear eyes and good voices and confidence, marvellous, marvellous poise and confidence. And watching them, I was so struck by the contrast with the children of Glasgow. The Cambridge children, you could see, came from generations of good feeding, good housing, good education, and choice. The Glasgow children were representing generations, I felt, of the lack of all these things.
In Lilybank, for King's College Chapel, read Dunning Street Close. The nearest the youngsters here get to artistic expression are walls decorated with graffiti.
These places are terrible, Matt, because for the day newer of a river painter, it gradually went on every night, were more put on it, and another night were more put on it. There came one time and seen my door before it was painted. You couldn't get a uranium in it with that full of names.
Are you going to make that dump, isn't you?
I know, it's terrible.
Well, who's making the dump? Eh? Who's making the dump? Who's making the dump? Who's to pay for all this? Your mother and your father's to pay for it.
I'm not going to
blame it. Is that true?
Right.
There's no date in your own place, but you're always coming picking this close. The people up in the school stand and get peace for you. Do you think it's funny? Aye, really, no. Do you really think it's funny?
We've been on the coast for ages.
So this point, but I mean, the people up the coast can't
get peace. Money, I've not used that place. Money was on that place.
Smoking on it, aye.
Stuff and everything's done in this close. This is the headquarters. And the people on the street's sick here.
And it's not just the graffiti. The close is also where the youngsters sniff glue. It's become the juvenile equivalent of escape through alcohol.
You can smell it when you go down at night. I don't know anything, but I saw a couple of them standing out there late at night, sniffing and sitting round the back at the mid and sniffing, but I don't know any of them.
I found it devastating to see small children, you know, the, again, the preschool ones, going along the road playing the game of glue sniffing. They weren't actually glue sniffing, but they had an empty potato crisp packet, which they were holding up to their noses like that, and staggering along the street, playing the game that they have seen their big brothers doing. Neither parents nor children were aware of the potentiality for brain damage that is inherent in glue sniffing. And to the adults as well as the children, while they vaguely knew it was something that should be disapproved of, they did not in fact have the basic information about it that would have roused them to take some kind of action on it. I mean, it was like, you know, stealing something from a shop. It was to be generally disapproved of, but you didn't take it terribly seriously. And you certainly didn't ally yourself with the police against the children in your community, because the police are seen very much as outsiders.
What happens if somebody calls the police?
The police don't come. Aye, they come, but you just have to wait. You need the phones, you police.
Why do you think that is?
Don't know.
I'm scared. When did you get put in or out?
Yeah, I had two windows broken. The woman in the bottom, she's done the same. She's had the back and front windows put in.
I mean, you're fair to check it too much in case you get your windows broke.
Because there's nobody there to put them down.
This was empty for a long time, and that woman's only an old pensioner. Every time she commutes, she was caught by the throat or shoved about.
Threatened.
An old pensioner.
One of them got hold of me and says, if you don't shut your mouth, I went and shut your door, old woman. I said, it's no use paying the rent, it's me. If you don't go to the road, I'll get the police for you. They just make a fool of you.
And if you do call the police, what happens?
Police never say the police to call them.
What do you mean?
You're going to get time to go and look, call for the police. You're afraid to leave your door, that's to tell you the truth. Then maybe sometimes you're sitting all of a sudden, a big brick comes through the window.
Has that happened to you?
Yeah, it's happened. 3 times. Then another time, there was a shotgun came through the window.
And who was doing this? Have you any idea?
Maybe when you're out to see who's dying it, nobody knows, but they're all standing around.
And when you see the police car coming in, you know, into the scheme, and it sits there for a few minutes, and then it drives off, it is simply there as a warning and a threatening and a menacing symbol of authority. The notion that the police can have a protective role in relation to them is really quite strange.
Oh, the police come here and they run away again, as far as I'm led to believe. The police are fear of them. That's the only thing you can take out of it. You could get murdered down there and wait 4 hours for a police coming. I've seen the police getting sent for, and it driving up like a snail's gallop to the motor, and just driving right by, because they've all run in closes. Am I right there, Isa? They come up like snail's gallop. There's no highway patrol here.
Is all this debris, this sort of terrible sense of damage everywhere, is this just being done by a few antisocial tenants, as they'd be called?
No, that's one of these absurd oversimplifications that officials indulge in when they're looking for simple solutions to complex problems. In fact, this damage and debris is about a whole community that doesn't have a feeling of responsibility for its total environment because they've never been given responsibility. And the end result is that you have people living here as if they were in tied cottages, many of them wanting to get out, knowing that they have absolutely no hope of a transfer to another scheme, because by the virtue of living here, they're being identified as less than the best tenants. And nobody, in fact, will give them the opportunity to have a sense of responsibility about where they are. And that's something that is absolutely essential if people are going to care in a total kind of way about not only just their houses, but about the world they live in.
But how do people survive in an environment like this?
Well, one way is by retreating into their houses, and many of the families living here have beautiful houses. I mean, they'll, you know, the phrase is, the house is like a wee palace. And by doing that, they have a bit of area and territory over which they have some control.
Well, if they're in my close, I just open the window and just give them a nice wee mouthful. Which, I must say, they walk away. I've never had bothered with them. And my mice rolls are awful nice. Understood what I mean? But when I left the window and ball them out, they definitely go away. Fee my clothes. I can't say any more than that. But I can hang out the window and see them further down the street, which has nothing to do with me. As long as they keep my clothes right, I'm all right. If they're across the road there, it's nothing to do with me either. My clothes and my bit of the street is mine.
It's almost as if people have made their own fortresses. There are always people hanging out of the windows. There are an awful lot of old people who are just sitting, looking out of their windows to get some kind of stimulation, because nothing is provided in the community for them. People have withdrawn, as I say, into their own houses, and they will defend that territory. I mean, everybody's got chains on their doors or spy holes that they look through to see who's coming. There's a lot of real anxiety about that, about defending your own territory. But that doesn't extend into the street.
There seem to be an extraordinary number of dogs in this scheme.
Yes, I think you'll find that, generally speaking, the poorer an area, the more dogs there are in it. Dogs seem to have enormous symbolic significance in areas of great poverty. When a dog is brought in, as it usually is, as a puppy, it is a focus for a lot of tenderness. And later on, when the dog gets bigger, it becomes some kind of symbol, I'm sure, of power and virility and strength, and the dog is allowed to bark all the time. I mean, I would lie here in bed at night listening to packs of dogs howling their heads off.
It seems that the poorer the area, the larger the dogs.
I think this is true. I think that you've got to be pretty rich to feel that your status is enhanced by a chihuahua.
As Mrs. Price, Kay Carmichael allowed herself only the income she could have expected from supplementary benefits, £10.90 as it was then. But she didn't draw it from Social Security. She rationed herself strictly from her own money.
I put aside £2.50 every week for heating and lighting and cooking, gas and electricity, in other words. And that left me with, if you can help with my arithmetic, £8.40.
Give or take.
Yes. I saved £1 a week out of that for emergencies, because I was conscious all the time of emergencies. I don't know what good £1 a week would have done me, but there was a kind of feeling that if I did that, you know, I had something to fall back on. And I lived entirely on the £7.40 that was left.
Was that adequate?
No, it wouldn't have been adequate. It was adequate in the sense that, all right, I was fed. I was fed, healthily fed. I had absolutely no room in my life for luxuries.
Drink or smoke. She didn't take tea or coffee. Her only luxury was an occasional bowl of homemade soup for 10p in a cafe just outside Lilybank.
I was living really on subsistence level, and it was really rather marvellous to have something actually cooked for me. And that was part of it, you know, part of it was being treated in a certain kind of way, because they, you know, to be looked after is really very important, and I was feeling pretty deprived in that respect as well.
Did you find that the level of subsistence that you were at left you
nothing for extras? You know, if you suddenly needed an extra pullover or something like that.
I couldn't possibly have bought anything extra. In fact, I had one moment of real panic. The coat I was wearing, which I had bought before I came, it had cost me £7.99 in a sale. And it was made of plastic, and it was really rather horrible because when it was hot weather, it was too hot, and when it was cold, the wind went right through it. And one day I was in the park, and I nearly caught it in a nail. And I realised that if it had ripped, I would have been absolutely stuck. It was the only coat I had. And by that time, I think I had saved about £4. And there was no way in which I could have got an alternative coat. I would have had to have gone and bought elastic plaster or something and stuck it together.
When you're poor, shopping is a constant insult to your pride, a relentless reminder that poverty denies you the right to choose.
I think I felt constantly outside because I would look in these shop windows and see things I needed and know that there was no way in which I could buy them. I mean, my money simply wouldn't stretch to it. It was as much as I could do to manage to live at a very simple level. And you go up and down here and you see things like carpets and that you would like to have. I mean, I think that is the terrible thing about it. You're always seeing things that you would in fact like to have. And it increases your sense of helplessness.
And all the time in our strident consumer society, rich and poor alike are being exhorted to help themselves to the good things of life.
I got so angry that there were all these things there that I needed and I couldn't have. It was all spread out, you know, so beautifully and so invitingly, but I knew exactly how much money I had in my pocket and that there were things that no matter how much I wanted them, I just couldn't have. And this feeling built up very strongly, and I found myself with a compulsion to steal something.
Temptation may be most acute when you are poor, but petty dishonesty is pandemic at every level of society, from back greens to big business. Where it really matters, Lilybank has its own strict code of morality, and for breaking that code, one Lilybank mother was prepared to send her own son to prison.
I phoned the police, my work, and tell them to come and lock my son out of my house. But they hadn't come to him in at 9:15 in the morning. Am I right, Michael? Huh? And Michael got 6 months for what he done. Because I think he was entitled to daytime. You just can't break into people, working class people's houses. More so people that's been awful good to you. For you're a wee boy, it was awful fond of you. And you still live in the building. Him and two or three of his pals broke into a woman in the building's house while she was at work. She was a spinster woman, had to work all her days for anything she had. Just the way I've had to work. We've got to work for worth shillings, as you know. And I found out. And I tell the detective she was with him. But he'd done nothing. He wouldn't open his mouth to get him to jail. And they got records in my house. Records. And they asked me were they were mine, and I said, no, they got about 36 under his mattress. And they asked me were they were my records, and I said, no. And they told me if I said they were my records, they couldn't give him the deal. But they weren't mine, and I wasn't saying they were mine. So they taken them away, and they got 6 months. That's all it was about.
She had to do it. I mean, I done wrong. Not because I gave her a bad name. Gave myself a bad name. I've never loved it done since. So, she done the right thing.
How do you feel about your mother?
I love her, didn't I? Some way if I didn't. She's my mother, and that's it. No matter what the circumstances are, no matter what she does to me, she's still my mother. I didn't think I was letting her down at the time, but I did let her down. I wasn't thinking of these things at the time. It was after it, as I say, when you're lying in a cell in Berlin, you start to think about the things you've done and how wrong you were. And you ask yourself, what did you do it for? Still no got an answer because you don't know what you've done it for.
Social security, with all its attendant frustrations and temptations, is perforce a way of life for many of the people of Lilybank. The easiest reaction from the comfort of your armchair or some other safe seat is to condemn all those on social security as merely scroungers. It's too easy to forget that they're not on social security by choice. Steady jobs are hard to find in Lilybank. The old heavy industries that used to provide work on the spot have gone from the East End. All that's left among the debris are people without work and without much hope.
How in the name of God can a civilized society tolerate people living in this kind of area, and particularly children growing up? And what hope have these children got of being full creative people in their adult lives when this is all they're offered in childhood?
Are they already doomed to be unemployable, do you think?
Well, many of them are doomed before they go to school not to be able to use the educational system. When they get into school, the school doesn't give them very much more. And then, by the time they leave school, society doesn't want them. They're the trash on the rubbish bin. And there is practically no opportunity for them to get skilled occupations. And the children know this. This is a terrible thing, talking to a couple of kids in the park over there one day and asking them what they're going to do when they left school. One of them says, oh, I suppose I'll go in the broom. They have this feeling
of their... It becomes a profession.
It becomes an identity rather than a profession. I mean, what is happening with the unemployed and with people on social security is that they are just managing to hold their own. And the assumption that every trade unionist makes that if he hasn't got a car this year, he should have one next year. And if he's got one car this year, then perhaps his wife can afford one next year. Because you had to have something to show that your standard of living was better than it had been the year before. That kind of society has no place for this group of people who, as I say, are just fixed income people, basically, who are just managing to keep abreast and swim. And some of them really aren't doing even that very well. Because if you look at the numbers of families who don't have things that the rest of us take for granted, like a refrigerator, like a washing machine, like a carpet sweeper, you find that in areas like this there are more and more like that, who are the excluded people. And this is what we're doing. We are saying about a certain group of people in our society that we're excluding them from all the things that everybody else takes for granted.
Isn't perhaps the most dismaying prospect the possibility that we're continually creating sort of self-perpetuating areas of people, what I think you call the fourth world, who will never get out of it?
If we go on the way we're doing, this is precisely what is happening. That as societies move on and become more affluent, they leave behind washed up wave of human beings for whom there doesn't seem to be any place in that new society. And we try to keep them reasonably quiet, reasonably under control, by paying them, you know, if they're unemployed, paying them unemployment benefits, or if they're chronically sick, paying them sums of money through Social Security, always just enough to keep them ticking over and reasonably content. And that's going to get worse, it's going to get better. It's not going to get better because there are going to be more and more people being driven into that position as industry becomes more capital intensive and less labour intensive. There are going to be more and more people put out like that. And it's not only in Glasgow this is happening, it's all over.
Governments are only now beginning to recognise the appalling scale of the problem of the fourth world in our cities. In Glasgow alone, £120 million is earmarked to try to rehabilitate the East End. But how has the Fourth World been allowed to come into being at all?
Magnus, we are all responsible for Lily Bank. It is not one person, it's all of us who have contributed to allowing this to go on for generations. It didn't start yesterday, it started centuries ago. It is the nature of our society to decide that some people are unnecessary for the working of the economy and therefore to treat them as 10th-rate citizens who are not entitled to decent housing, education, health or anything else. And that's what we've got to change, the total relationships between all the groups of people in the community, and stop having the insiders and the outsiders, the included and the excluded. I would not want anybody to see me as somebody who was speaking for the people of Downing Street. I think the people of Downing Street are perfectly capable of speaking for themselves. And I get very angry with people who set themselves up as speaking for the less articulate. The people of Downing Street are very articulate, and they have very powerful things to say and very important things to say. The trouble is that there is a great reluctance on the part of the other community, the included as opposed to the excluded people, to hear what the people of Downing Street are saying.
And that's precisely what the people of Lilybank now try to do, to make their voice heard by forming a tenants' association.
We're looking for volunteers, we're looking for people that want to be responsible for the people of Lilybank. We're trying to create an environment where people will want a house here. If anybody is prepared to do that, by all means, they're quite welcome to come to the tenants' association to meeting tomorrow night.
I think they're the only people who can do it. I certainly don't think anyone else can. Unless the people of Lilybank are involved in a very powerful way in the running of their own lives, then all kinds of, you know, well-meaning people can drop in and try to do things, and nothing's going to happen.